How's everybody doing today? Oh, come on, we can do better than that. Did you hurt your hands on the way in? Come on. Let's welcome South Shore. South Shore, how you doing, family? We love you. Do you hear that? Come on, let's keep it going. Woo! We love you, South Shore. Our family away from home, I tell you, God is doing great things. I mean, think about how we can connect two campuses at the same time, impacting thousands of people in two different regions. Come on now, that's something to celebrate. That's something to be excited about, that we get to have that capability. Come on. Hallelujah. Something to celebrate at South Shore. We just recently kicked off again the Experiencing God studies, and we had over half the men of the church in South Shore sign up. They are currently going through it right now. It is exciting times for us because that's how you win a region. You grab them in and you get them plugged in. They'll win their homes. They'll win their families. They'll win the marketplace. Amen. And that's how we take over a region. Amen. Come on. God is so good. He is so good. Over half the men are in the study. Now, listen, it would be out of place for me not to love on my pastor, amen, that I love dearly, our pastor, our lead pastor, Pastor Greg Dumas, and his wife, Pastor Tamara. Come on, let's clap it up. Pastor, we love you. Come on, you hear that, Pastor? We love you. Yes. He is ready to get on this platform. Amen. In fact, speaking of Pastor Greg, let's go ahead and hear from him now.
Hi, Crossing family. Wanted to just take this short opportunity to say thank you to all of you. It sure wasn't my intention to rupture my Achilles tendon. All of your cards and notes and really kind expressions of love, the food that we've received, the outpouring that we've received has really, really blessed us and has made a somewhat difficult time a whole lot easier to bear. I am doing great. I'll be back with you just as soon as possible. Thank you for being patient with us. Our pastors have done just an amazing job. I've got to sit on this side and watch all that's taking place and really impressed with our team and our pastors. So when I come back, I'm gonna be doing video for a little while. Thank you for being patient for that. I just can't stand up on my leg for another short time. But I'm ready to come back and see you just as soon as I get clearance from the doctor. A couple things. One, for those of you who have not taken the opportunity to jump in with us for the 90-Day Tithe Challenge, it's been an incredible tool for us in the life of the Crossing Church. Many, many people have just taken that little added cushion to fully serve God with their resources. And so if you haven't done that and you'd like to do it, fill out your 90-Day Tithe Challenge card, turn it into the Welcome Center, both campuses. Hello, South Shore. Can't wait to see you even in person again. And get going so that you would know the fullness of God's grace and the fact that you can trust Him fully, of course, with your resource. And then lastly, we've made a slight adjustment to our Saturday night service time at the Tampa campus. Right now it's 4 and 5:45. We're moving that back just a little bit to 6 o'clock, and we're calling it After Party. And we're having two opportunities to relate and connect in a really organic fashion, to be together, entertainment, rotation with cool things that are taking place out on the patio. Bring a blanket. We've got great food for you, activities for the kids. Just a place to connect, to relate, to build friendships, to not hurry away. And that's in between the two services, right after the 4 o'clock, and then now in the shift, right after the 6 o'clock. And we hope to see you there. I can't wait. I know I said that already. I can't wait to get back to be with you all and to see you. And again, thanks so much for all of your expressions of love and grace. Have a great weekend. We love you. Can't wait to see you. God bless you.
Yes, we love you, Pastor. Amen. Amen. Listen, I'd like to also honor Pastor Jonas. Didn't he do an amazing job speaking on tithes last week? Oh, yes, he did. Oh, yes, he did. You know, I love his boldness when he talks about such a subject. You know, let me express something to you. We want to talk about the Bible. We want to preach the gospel. From this platform, you're not going to get anything watered down. You're going to get it from Genesis to Revelation. You're going to get the whole truth. You see, we're not going to take away, we're not going to add. and tithing is principle, and it's within the context of the Bible. Amen? And for us, it doesn't just start here in this platform. It happens at home. We teach the same and live by the same principles with our family at home. For me, 2 years ago when my daughter turned seven, Isabel turned seven, and on her birthday, she came running to the table and she said, "Papi, Theo just gave me 20 bucks. And I thought to myself, my goodness, she's going to expect 20 and then 30 and then 40 every year. By the time she turns 21, I'm going to be out a couple grand. And I said, my goodness, what did he do? And she came up with this $20 bill, and she brought it to me, and she was so excited. And I felt led at that moment to speak to my daughter about the tithing principle at 7 years old. Now, I grabbed a napkin, and I began to draw out $20 symbols. It looked a little something like that. And I wrote them out on the napkin, and I began to explain to her. I said, "Honey, listen," I said, "we get to give God a portion of this that he has given us." And I began to explain to her. I said, "A tenth with your $20 bill, it's going to be in the top right-hand corner." I boxed those two symbols. I said, "We get to give God $2. And she looked at me, you know, she turned her head, she said, "I got to give God $2, Dad?" I said, "Oh, I'm losing her." I said, "My goodness, I'm losing her." All of a sudden, she looked at me and she said, "You know what, Poppy? That's a pretty good deal." She said, "I get to keep $18? I said, "Yeah, baby." And I said, "Why is that a pretty good deal?" And I was holding the $20 bill like this. It was facing me, if you will. And she said, "Because in God we trust." I wrote it on the napkin, so I'll never forget. See, I'll never forget that in God we trust. You see, these doors are going to stay open, but we as a church, we want to see you abundantly above and beyond blessed. Amen. And that's why we talk to you about the tithe. It is the principle, amen, that gives you an overabundance. Amen. Now listen, if you find this 20, it's mine. Don't pick it up. Amen. It may fly out. I mean, and if you keep it, pay your tithes, okay? Amen. Amen. If you haven't jumped onto the 90-Day Tithe Challenge, make sure that you make your way out to the info desk and grab the card. Get it started. Trust me, it'll bless you and your family. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you that there is a message in front of me, God, that I get to have this opportunity to speak to your people, and that includes me. Father God, I've prepared. Father God, I've studied. I've spent hours on it, but Lord, if it be your will, use it. If not, amen. God, I give you the glory. May I step aside and that you step in the name of Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Here's the title of the message. We can't stay here. We can't continue to stay where we're at. You see, I want to talk to you today about the valleys, but I also want to talk to you about the significance of the mountaintop. You see, there is a blessing that's awaiting us, and it's time for us to get out of where we're at. Amen? Let's see what the Bible says. Matthew 17, if you can. I'm going to be reading to you from verses 1 through 9. If you can, pull your Bibles out, your iPad, your iPhone, and go with me. This is a story, I know we all know it, when Jesus was transfigured on the mount. Now, I'm going to read fast, so listen to me fast. Amen? Verse 1 says, "Now, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother. He led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, 'Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah.' While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom that great I am, in whom I am well pleased.' He says, 'Hear him.' And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, 'Arise and do not be afraid.' When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. Here's the big idea, church. Fruit grows in the valley, but revelation happens on the mountaintop. Come on, I'm going to say that again. Maybe it'll sink in a little bit. Fruit grows in the valley, but revelation happens on the mountaintop. Let me break down these verses with you. Verse 1, it says, now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led him up on a high mountain by themselves. In other words, he set them apart. You see, God is wanting to take a few of us, amen, a handful of us. He wants to separate us and take us up on top of this mountain. You see, we're not valley people. We are mountaintop kind of folks. Amen. You see, God wants to separate us. You see, I believe that for a lot of us in this church right now, online at South Shore, we have stayed in the valley for so long, and God is saying, listen, I just want to take a handful of you. I want to take you out of where you're at, your current circumstance, the place that you have been for so long, and I want to show you something greater on top of this mountain. You see, we're not meant to live in the mountain. God wants to separate us. He wants to take us apart. Verse 2 says, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. You see, God wants to reveal himself in a deeper way to us. And listen to me, church, it's not going to happen in the valley. You see, he wants to take us from the valley and transfigure. He wants to reveal himself in a greater way. And trust me, I understand. For a lot of us, we've been in the valley so long that we've gotten accustomed to the way things are, and there is nothing else. You have ups and downs, and you say, well, you know what? Pastor, you don't understand. I've been going through some things. Well, let me tell you something. God wants to reveal himself to you. But, Pastor, I'm going through marital issues, my husband or my wife. But listen to me. God wants to reveal himself to you. Well, you say, well, Pastor, my financial burdens, I can't keep going like this. Listen to me. God wants to reveal himself to you. It's time for us to get out of the valley and start making our climb up to the mountaintop, because he has a revelation awaiting you, and he has a revelation awaiting me. It's time to leave the valley. And I know all too well here and at South Shore, I know all too well that you're going through things. And you've gathered all the fruit there is to gather in the valley. But listen to me. God wants to do something for you. I feel like somebody in the house, well, God, you don't understand. I've been sick. I've been bedridden. God wants to reveal himself to you. But I can't conceive, God. No. Listen to me. God wants to reveal himself to you. His glory is on that mountain. And all we have to do is take the climb. Will we take the climb is the question. Will we get out of that valley? Or we've been stuck too long in the valley. And listen to me, church, I'm not telling you that God cannot speak to you in the valley. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere. He speaks in the valley, but revelation happens on the mountaintop. Amen. Come on, get a hold of this. We are not valley folks, y'all. We're mountaintop kind of people. Come on, church. You know, I want to get on top of that mountain, and I want to say, God, I thought I knew you, but my God, I know you. That's the revelation that I want. You see, the valley doesn't change. We are the ones that are supposed to change and come back down to the valley to bring about revelation. We're not meant to stay here. It's time to take that climb. It's not time to quit. It's time to climb, church. Verses 3 and 4, he says, and behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles. In fact, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. Listen to me. I can't stand still. I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to walk. Amen. Listen to me. Peter gets on top of this mountain. He sees Jesus all of a sudden transfigure. His clothes is like the light, and his face became like the sun. And all of a sudden, Moses pops out of nowhere, giving him a high five. Hey, what's going on? I'm in the house. And then all of a sudden, you have Elijah pop out of nowhere, and he's in the house. And Peter's like, oh, my goodness. I mean, Jesus just transfigured himself. And I have Moses, which represents the law here. And then I have Elijah, which represents the prophecy, the prophets. So it's no wonder Peter doesn't want to live. In fact, he says, God, I would love to build you a house. You want a pool? You want a three-story, two-story? You want a basement? Amen. You want a jacuzzi? I can get one of those. Amen. He is ready to build a house. He doesn't want to leave. Imagine the top of the mountain experience that you can have with our Savior. This isn't privy to James, John, and Peter. This is for you and me. Peter does not want to leave. In fact, I can't blame him. To see the glory of God, for God to reveal himself to them, and then Moses and Elijah to come out of nowhere. Imagine that revelation. God wants to give you one of those mountaintops experiences. We've been stuck in a valley too long, church. I'm just going to be real with you. I'm not excluding myself. I've been in a valley. I've experienced a valley. But let me tell you something. I got my revelation on the mountaintop. Fruit grows in a valley, but revelation happens on the mountaintop. Verses 5 and 6. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is. It's not, it might be, it can be, this is. We got to hear that, church. This is my beloved son, in whom I am. There's that great I am, in whom I am well pleased, period. He says, hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell to their faces and were greatly afraid. Let me explain. Some versions will say, listen to him. I like the versions that says, hear him. Listening is listening to what I'm saying, and then you take action. That's good. That's really good. But when you hear God, when you hear God, is to perceive with the ear the sound that's being made by someone or something. It's different. When you get down in your prayer time and you get quiet in your quiet time and you get with God and you just, it's like a child in a supermarket and you can hear them calling for their mom because they're lost. And you can almost hear Billy, Poppy, Mommy, you can almost perceive with the ear. You have to get into a place where you're not listening, but you're so in tune. When we get into our prayer life, amen, and we get down before God, and he starts to speak, it's like that. You got to, like, turn your head a little bit. You're like, God, I hear you. God, I hear you speaking. I haven't been obedient, but I'm going to do it. God, I hear you. Do you hear that? It's that still voice of God speaking to you, his anointed, his called, his chosen, the one that he has set apart, the ones that he has taken out of the valley to the mountaintop. You are it. He is speaking, and we have to hear his voice. That still voice, that's not you going crazy. That's God talking, stretching you, asking you to do some supernatural, out of this world kind of stuff. He's asking you because he has chosen you to be faithful. Listen, I'm looking at some Peters, some James, and some Johns in the house of God. Amen. And he has taken you from the valley, and he is making his ascent. You are walking up the mountain. Listen to me. Do not give up. Don't give up. It's time to make the climb. Come on, church. The Bible says in verse 7, he says, verses 7 and 8, he says, but Jesus came and touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. This is, some people need to be touched. Oh, come on, church. Oh, Pastor getting all spiritual up there. Listen to me. Some people need to feel that touch of God. I know what it is to be sitting there behind closed doors, asking God why, seeking him, say, Lord, please help me. God, would you just see about me? Oh, I'm talking to somebody. Some people need to be touched. But we also, more importantly, need to hear the words, arise and do not be afraid. Because here's the deal. The Bible says in verse 8, and when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw nothing but Jesus. You see, when we're touched with God, by God, all we see is his glory. Some of us need to be touched. Verse 9 says, and I'll start landing here. Now, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. You see, God was telling them not to share the vision. He told them that. But he was not telling them to not share their experience. You see, he said, hold fast to what you saw. But he didn't tell them, don't share your experience. No, he wants them to share their experience. You see, just recently, I know what these valleys and mountaintops look like. Recently, about a week ago, I went to Guatemala. And I was there with a team of a medical team. And we went to Guatemala, and we went to Antigua, right there in the valley. And I saw great things happen. I saw the surgical team. I saw surgeons and doctors and nurses and anesthesiologists come together. And then we broke up into separate teams, praise God, and they started to do total knee replacements. They started to repair ACLs. They pulled out gallbladders and repair hernias, and they started to do great things for a people that could not afford to do otherwise. They did great surgeries in the valley. There was great fruit. And then me and Dr. Richard Rivas, we went in and we did a little different kind of surgery, man. I call it supernatural surgery. Come on, somebody. We had over 80 people receive Jesus Christ. Healing instantaneous. The prophetic started to flow right there in the valley. Great fruit. People started to receive the Holy Spirit. Over 80 people saved right in the valley. See, but God had a mountaintop experience waiting for me. I had the opportunity on Friday to be off. Now, I Sabbath on Friday. That's my day to Sabbath. Now, listen to me. I don't know if you're taking your Sabbath, but you need to seek the Lord about that. Guys will ask me from time to time, to say, man, Pastor, how do you always get it? You're always running. And I tell them, man, because I Sabbath well. It's not about just resting and staying in my word. It's about resting in the Lord. So when I was up there, I was invited to take a little tour of the city on my Sabbath. And I said, man, what great way to go and spend some time with Jesus and experience God than to see these amazing volcanoes and mountaintops and crops. And I said, yeah, I'll take a bike ride. Easy, let's do it. So I went there. Let me give you a little explanation in comparison to Tampa. Antigua is about 5,000 feet high. Tampa is about 20 feet. It's a little difference, slight difference. Okay, it's equivalent to about a mile. In fact, a mile is 5,280 feet. So it's like, to give you a picture, I'm a picture kind of guy, it's like grabbing 4.5 Empire State Buildings and stacking them on top of each other. Now, I went to take this little tour, this little bike ride. I said, man, I love to take that little scenic route. Why not? So I get on there, and I make it to the place, and all of a sudden, they tell me the name. I said, well, what's the name of this thing that we're doing? And it's called, in Spanish, Las Tierras Altas, which is high ground. And I said, okay, cool. Then they said, it's about 22 miles. I said, oh, my God. You see the red? That's my blood running down the mountain that, right there. Amen. I mean, Jesus helped me out. You look at the bottom, that graph, just to kind of give you the elevation from the bottom to the very top. It's not a flat run. It was high ground. It was Las Tierras Altas, for real. So I get there, and I'm thinking, man, you know what? I go to the gym 3 times a week. I got this. I do cardio 5 or 6 times a week. I'm good. I got this. I'm good. I'm like, man, give me my bike. I am ready to do this. This is me in the valley with Dr. Richard. Smiling. Kool-Aid smile. Haven't had a drop of Kool-Aid, but I'm just smiling. And I'm there, I'm getting ready. I'm like, come on, let's do this, let's roll. And I get on this bike and I start trekking. About 20 minutes in, this is what it looks like. See me in the background? That's my what in the world did I just do look. Then about 30 minutes in, we take another stop, and I think I'm doing pretty well. I look a little something like this. I'm in the background. God bless Dr. Richard. He wanted to capture every moment. Yes, bless him. And then about 40 minutes in, 40 some odd minutes in, we're going down the steep hill and the same way up, and we're getting to the very top of this mountain. You saw the altitude. We're getting there. Listen to me, I get to this place where I have to push my bike up because most of us can't bike it up, and all of a sudden, I lose my breath, and I start to breathe like this, and this is what I look like. He captured that picture as well. God bless him. I'm not going to lie to you. I just tossed my cookies right there. He captured it. He did. Right then and there, it all happened. But you know what happened as well? At that very moment, God spoke to me. At that moment, while I was hunched over like this, the Holy Spirit said, you know why I let you go through this? And my ear did one of these hear him. I said, so what did you say, God? I said, what did you say, God? He said, because many people make it into the valley to never find a way out of the mountaintop. He said, I'm going to use you to lead them out. That's what he told me right then and there. Listen to me. I talked to my tour guide, and he said, listen, Hector, you got to start breathing. You're not breathing. That ain't going to work. He said, I need you to breathe in, hold your breath for a second. He said, and then release it. Your lungs got to expand. He said, there's another thing, too. He said, I noticed that your seat is way low. He said, Hector, I need you to raise your seat up about hip high. He said, because you're only pushing with your thighs, I need you to push with your thighs, your knees, and your calves. He said, I need you to raise up that seat. You see, some of us need to raise that elevation of our lifestyle and get out of that valley and get onto the mountaintop. Let me tell you something. God was talking to me. God was talking to me. Listen to me, it's time to raise that seat. He said, Hector, listen to me. I'm also going to have you do a couple other things. He said, I'm going to need for you to continue your breathing pattern. He said, because it's time to fill your lungs up. Listen, fill your lungs up with the breath of God, church. Amen. He said, and as you're pushing, I want you to push not just with your knees, your calves, and your thighs. He said, but also I need you to focus. He said, don't focus directly on what's in front of you. You see, he said, when you look at what's in front of you, you can't see what lies ahead. He said, I need you to make sure that you start looking not here, because when it gets to here, listen to me, some of us are going through so much in our lives that we're only focused on what's right here in front of us, amen, that when it comes, we can't see it coming a mile away. You see, he said, don't focus on this. He said, focus on that. He said, so that you can have enough time. So because you're so focused on God, amen? This is what God was telling me. He said, you're so fixed on me that you can see the trial, the tribulation coming your way, that when it comes your way, you don't even need to wait till it gets here. You're already maneuvering around the obstacle, amen? He told me, he said, listen, come on now. Hallelujah. Come on. He told me, he said, Hector, listen, there's one more thing I got to tell you. He said, you got to get up off your butt. I said, what do you mean? He said, you're riding that bike. He said, you're sitting down. He said, and that bike is controlling you. He said, I need you to mount up. God said, mount up like wings of eagle. He said, mount up on top of that bike. Don't let it run you. You ride it. Amen? Listen to me. It's time for us to get up out of the valley onto the mountaintop and bring back about revelation for those that are stuck in the valley. Come on, church. I grabbed that bike. I said, oh, it's on now. You see, devil, you thought you had me played right here with my mind. My mind was lost. I wanted to die. I wanted to throw that bike right down the hill. I was so angry. But my body was saying, you can do this. And when I brought the two together, listen to me, some of us need to raise that seat up. Some of us need to mount on top of that bicycle. Stop pushing with your thighs in the struggles of life and push with your whole leg and start tumbling down and pushing down. And let me tell you something. When I mounted up on that bicycle, there was a moment when I said, my goodness, if I go to the left, somebody's going to have to pray for me. If I go to the right, I said, my goodness, a helicopter's going to have to find me. I mean, it was that risky. And here's what God said. He said, you fix your eyes on me. Here's what the scripture he gave me. While I'm on the trail, he says to me, I do not regard myself as having laid a hold of it yet, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind me. Forget what just happened, he said, but reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's time to get out of the valley. You are no longer valley folk. We are mountaintop revelation getting kind of people. Amen? Are you with me? Come on, church. Woo. Let me land it this way. Fruit grows in a valley, but revelation happens on a mountaintop. You see, I'm not going to stay stuck down here. You see, the fruit that I've gained, I've already gotten enough spiritually fat where I can make my way up to get some revelation. Because here's the deal. There are some people in the valley. Listen, there are some family members in your house that need to get out of that valley. There are some friends that you know of, those folks that are coming to mind right now, that need to get out of the valley. Amen. There are some neighbors. There's some people that you write down hate. Amen. That need to get up out of that valley. And it's going to take for you to get ourselves out of that valley, not quit, and make that climb to receive revelation on the mountaintop. So maybe you've been living in the valley for far too long. Maybe you've wanted to stay on top of the mountain because you have received such an amazing experience, like Peter, James, and John. Maybe that's you. But here's the thing. If we never leave the valley and take the climb, we will never receive revelation. And if we never leave the mountaintop, then how will we ever bring it to those that are in need in the valley? Think about that. Think about that. So here's what I want to do. If you've been in a valley too long, I want you to be bold right where you're at, and I just want to pray for you. Maybe you haven't been in a valley. Maybe you haven't, but maybe you have been to the mountaintop and you've been stuck there because God has been feeding you so much. So if that's you or either one of you, if you want to see God reveal himself to you even more, I just want you to stand up right where you're at and I just want to pray for you. Amen. If you want to see God move in your marriage and reveal himself to you from the valley to the mountaintop, stand up. If you're having a financial burden, for the love of Jesus, listen to me. Stand up. He wants to reveal himself to you. I said earlier, there's a woman that can't conceive. God wants to reveal himself to you, sweetheart. Stand up. God wants you to make the climb. And he wants you to descend. So those that are stuck in the valley can receive that revelation. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you. Look at your people. Father God, these are not valley folks anymore. They're a mountain climbing, revelation, grabbing on top of the mountain kind of people. Father God, I pray a blessing over each and every person that's here right now, God. I thank you that they are not just going to listen to the word, but they're going to be hearers of your word, Father God. They are going to grab and get up and get going and get trekking, Father God. They're going to elevate themselves, Father God. They are going to focus on you and not what lies in front of them, Father God. They are going to start breathing, Father God, you, Lord, your life, so that they can make this mountain journey, Father God, so that then they can bring it about to those in the valley. God, look at your faithful people right now. Look at them, Lord. This is your army, your faithful few, God, that you have taken and you've set apart. So, Father, I pray a blessing for everyone that wants to receive. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now remain standing for me for just a second. For just a second. Listen to me. Verse 7 was telling us, some of us need to be touched in the house of God. You haven't been touched. You've been coming, but you haven't committed. Listen to me. I know it's scary, right? But let me tell you what God said. Arise and don't be afraid. God wants to move in your life and in your family's life, all you have to do is say, here am I, Lord. Take me. So if you haven't received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior all together, I want us to pray. Pray together. But I want us to remain standing. If you pray this prayer for the very first time, I want you to remain standing. Be bold. Arise and don't be afraid. And everyone else sits. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your only son to die for me. He has healed me and set me free. Lord, I welcome him into my life to lead and guide me all my days. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, here and at South Shore, on the count of three, listen to me. I want you to be bold. Remain standing for me if you prayed that prayer for the first time and everyone else sits down. On the count of three, one, two, three. Come on. Come on. Come on, I see you. Come on. I see you. Come on. I see you. Come on. Come on now. I see you. I see you. I see you. I see you. Come on, somebody. Come on. That's how you do it right there. Come on, embrace them. Embrace them. Embrace them. Embrace them. Embrace them. Embrace them. Come on. Embrace that man in the back. Come on, embrace them. That's right. Come around them. Come on. Woo! That's right. Embrace them. There you go. Embrace that brother. Embrace that brother. Come on. Embrace that sister. Come on. Woo! Embrace them. You will never be the same again. Never be the same again. There's a card right there. They'll help you. Hey, listen, folks that just stood up, the people around, here's what I'm asking you. Get out of the valley. Approach them. Walk with them. Love on them. Connect them. Grab that connect card, and I want you to fill it out. Amen. There you go, baby. Tears of joy. Come on now. I want you to fill out that connect card. And I want you to take it to the today I decided, but I want somebody around, a group of you, all of you, to grab them and walk them over there. Amen. Let's do this as a family. Amen. And listen to me. If you don't remember one thing I've said today, it's time to arise and not be afraid. Let's get out of the valley so we can receive revelation on the mountaintop. God bless you.